né, para o nosso 7º Congresso Internacional do Grupo Uni. Estamos a receber o professor Andreas. O professor vem da África do Sul, não é? E inclusive é a primeira vez que nós recebemos alguém da África do Sul para palestrar no nosso congresso. E o tema do professor centrará sobretudo na diversidade cultural em África e a resolução de conflitos. E para moderar a palestra, teremos a Estela, que é professora do Grupo UNIS, e ela estuda, pronto, né, essas causas, relações internacionais, refugiados e por aí vai. Então, para começar, eu vou passar para vocês quem é o professor Andreas Dries. Então, vamos lá. Professor Andrea Veldhuizen is a part of the faculty of Tabumbeki African School of Public and International Affairs at the University of South Africa, UNISA. His scholarly vocation is the supervision of postgraduate students and teaching on public leadership for peace, conflict resolution, election management, and security management in Africa. He is also an NRF Red Researcher in African Peace of Conflict Studies. His qualifications include a D. Little et Phil degree in politics and MI and BI Hons degrees in strategy studies, as well as a BI degree in international politics. He published intensively and present his work at academic conference and workshops on most continents in the world. Currently, he is co-editor-in-chief of the reputable African Security Review Journal and associate of the London-based Professor Without Borders. Dries is an active member of the Rotary Club of Dick Street 9400, appropriately focusing on peace and conflict resolution as leader of a vocational training team to train Rotary mediators to work with social community in Africa. This is Professor Andreas Dries Veldhuizen. Now I will present Stella. Stella, it's her area of study is international law, international and refugees and etc. And Stella work at UNIS Group. Professor Dries, first one, I would like say something. Now we make history, because in 15 years of story of UNIS Group, is the first time that we received someone from University of South Africa or someone from South Africa. Therefore, I want to thank you a lot, and thank you, Professor Siza Mugabane, to link Group UNIS and you. And then, Professor, the screen is all yours. Thank you very much, and good presentation. We can hear you, Professor. No?
Okay. Now
Okay,
you're
now it's okay.
able to hear me. I just want to make sure that you can see the screen.
Yes, you can. It's all fine.
Wonderful. Thank you. Let me just maximize it. And then, thank you very much for this opportunity. It's always a privilege to be invited to an international conference, especially in a country where I've never been. And a special thanks for Professor Siza Magubane, who facilitated this event. I will be speaking, as promised, on cultural diversity and peace in Africa, towards a future of synergy, action in silencing the guns. The emphasis being on synergy, synergy action. It takes place against the background of a history of colonialism and a time when Africa has been part of, served as Cold War proxies for the different major powers in the world. Those experiences detached Africans from their own governance structures. It was followed by failed reconstruction and development programs that was driven from outside Africa. Poverty and inequality fueled by geopolitics, geopolitical ambitions, and exploitative exploration by powerful nations in the world continues today. The ambitions of for world peace and objectives of the Peace and Security Council of the United Nations, Africa prescribed to that, as well as to the Sustainable Development Goals, especially Goal 16, that says, promote peaceful and inclusive societies for sustainable development, provide access to justice for all, and build effective, accountable, and inclusive institutions at all levels. So as people from Africa, we subscribe and support these objectives, keeping in mind that we have a very unique history, as I was mentioned in the beginning. That history is articulated, or the future is articulated in Agenda 2063 of the African Union, where there are certain aspirations. And my work focus on the aspiration of Agenda 2063, the quest for silencing the guns, which actually means making peace in Africa. The aim of my presentation today is to discuss the imperative of synergy of action to silence the guns in Africa. It is very important for us to bring peace. Otherwise, nothing else can happen. In my research, I asked the question, how the interaction among rulers of sovereign states can be broadened and deepened to include the voices of all citizens in decision-making, irrespective of where they dwell. Because I argue that the peace and development agenda in Africa is dominated by elite multilateral organizations and governments, we do not succeed in creating a secure space for the people of Africa. So we need a synergy of action between the diverse people of Africa to implement government's decision in the interest of all, and not just a few elite groups. To achieve my aim today, I will briefly discuss the quest for peace in Africa, understanding diversity in Africa, and then I will end with some conclusions and remarks on the synergy in implementing security decisions in Africa. And then, of course, there will be some time, as the facilitator allows me, for comments and questions. But first, look at violent conflict in Africa. The pattern of violent conflict in Africa, despite many progressive moves in the continent, continues, unfortunately. The geopolitical power imbalances and social divides that is part of the world we are living in remains. Therefore, there are persisting imbalances in distribution of power and wealth, of which Africa are always at the shortest end. In Africa itself, we have a cynical self-interest, corruption by political rulers that result in unsuccessful implementation of development programs. Impaired democratization manifests itself in the dysfunctional processes and institutions for people to exercise democratic freedoms. And in this regard, repressive securitization measures by rulers to retain power persist. There is abuse of ethnic and religious differences. Rival politicians are very good at employing ethnic sentiments to gain power and control over resources. Then we see today in our midst the proliferation of rebels, extremist groups, and terrorism, with linkages with transnational organized crime, what I call the crime pipeline. The phenomenon of climate change leads to mass migration, anti-migrant violence, power supply problems, politicization of drought, and deteriorating health conditions. The current pandemic is putting pressure on government systems, adding to the growing frustrations among people that turns into aggression. Like the rest of the world, we are living with technological changes, especially increased connectivity, that causes an emerging insecure cyberspace that will put a demand on a trade-off between security on the one side and maintaining the freedom of communication on the other side. Then we have African peace and security architecture that is struggling to implement resolutions. This is a very bleak picture, so I must immediately say they are the brighter side, but unfortunately, to look for solutions, we need to initially look at what is the gap, what are the challenges and the complex problems that we have. Coming back to the African peace and security architecture, is part of the African Union. The African Union working in partnership with the United Nations and other relevant international stakeholders, such as the European Union and the People's Republic of China, which is becoming a prominent role player nowadays. Unfortunately, this peace and security architecture cannot be described as successful. Despite some successes and, as I said, some progress by deploying various instruments of conflict resolution and some operational efficiency, the effectiveness of conflict prevention depends on member states, the participation of the member states, and on the external stakeholders. At this point, violent conflict continues in, for instance, Darfur, South Sudan, Somalia, the Eastern DRC, the Gulf of Guinea, the Lake Chad Basin, and the Cabo Delgado province of Mozambique. And I'm talking about day-to-day violent conflict. Top-down solutions on African Union level do not collaborate with the interests of most member states. Your nation states in Africa shows a preference for building national capacities instead of contributing to pan-African security. These states still believe that they can secure themselves without concern that the security of the nation state is bound to the security of its neighbors. Africa is diverse in terms of ethnicity, culture, race, language, socioeconomic status, and religion. Now, how can Africa minimize this diversity or capitalize on this diversity in order to forge unity? Unity is very important to overcome all these challenges that I mentioned. Well, from a start, the popular view is that the introduction of multicultural education in each and every state in Africa can minimize these conflicts, which are destroying humanity and its infrastructure. Education, multicultural education can provide a framework for addressing social, economic, political, and educational inequalities. Education can reduce the pain and discrimination that members of some ethnic and racial groups experience because of their unique racial, physical, and cultural characteristics. Education can assist individuals to gain greater self-understanding by viewing themselves from the perspectives of their own community cultures within the mainstream social culture, within and across other ethnic cultures. African knowledge systems is an epistemological system of special relationships between human agency and solidarity among people. Now, African knowledge systems is a way of integrating or fusing these diversities and maximize the use of diversities to find solutions for peace in Africa. African knowledge system is a totality of all knowledge and practices, explicit or implicit, used in the management of socioeconomic, spiritual, and ecological aspects of life. You can read more the work of Professor Catherine Adora Hoppers. She's very well published. The same is Professor Nabudere, who says that African knowledge systems is a value-adding relationship between African knowledge and other cultures, drawing on the culture on the cultural heritage of Africa while considering new developments in the world. So it's nothing, it's not isolationism. It is not something to claim that we are unique and should be totally isolated from the world. African knowledge is part of the mainstream of new developments in the world. And that will help us to find solutions. For instance, to find equally important, your African knowledge systems is equally important for policy development and implementation. African knowledge systems is a valuable resource for democratic governance programs. It facilitates and involves the collaboration with communities for better governance. It includes the voices of all citizens as equal partners, claiming agency in decision making and implementation. The advocacy role of formal and informal civil society structures plays a very important role here. And that is actually the crux of my presentation. The big challenge is to include the voices of all citizens as equal partners. We cannot have a situation anymore where elite, a small group of people is running a country, excluding the rest of the people in the country from decisions. Your communities and your people living in poorer communities are now claiming agency in this decision making and how to implement it, which is not a very easy task. Therefore, your formal and informal civil society structures are very important to act as advocates of human agency by the people. Your African knowledge systems as an approach meets the demand for local ownership to reduce dependency and exploitation by foreign investors, which South Africa is still very sensitive for, that they retain local ownership. It doesn't mean if you loan money or get grants from somewhere else that you hand over ownership of implementation. The challenge remains is how to integrate diversity. And I'm quoting Shugudu there, who says that for policy, teaching, and society, African institutions need to integrate diversity at managerial levels and in their strategic plans, in as much as they are trying to do with gender equality at the moment. Gender equality, as international rest of the world, is currently on the agenda in Africa. And just as gender diversity, so much it must be for the same, it must be for cultural diversity on the agenda to make sure, and it must be in our strategies and plans for implementation. Africa must make cultural diversity an intrinsic part of from the institutional value system, and identify it as an asset to utilize it towards progress of the continent. So it's a value issue. It's based on values. And what is that value foundation that we talk about? We need a new emphasis on group dynamics that accommodate diverse worldviews, founded on the fundamental values of mutual respect, dignity of the person, and togetherness. People call it Bothu in Sesotho, Ubuntu in isiZulu, we eliminate in Afrikaans, my first language, and in your language, respect to mutu e tolerancia, Portuguese. So that is the value foundation that we need to facilitate and promote diversity in Africa that can be used on all levels to find solutions, including solutions for violent conflict. And I decided to quote, to use two powerful theoretical quotes here, or quotes by theoreticians, Varner and Bremer, that said, culture explains how people make sense of their world. This is the way we view the world, is from our cultural perspective. And nowadays, cultures are not mutually exclusive, but there are some unique traits in many cultures. According to Hofstede, the collective programming of the mind acquired by growing up in a particular country and culture is the software of the mind. Culture as software of the mind. I find that very important, especially if we ask, how do we make meaning of our world? And how does that inform our different views of the world? By way of conclusion, I just want to say that diversity management for peace is indispensable for innovative made in Africa policies. Some people say the African way, strategies and synergy of action. Policy and the implementation part of their strategies and synergy of action. African communities are part of the mix to find synergy among the people in Africa. We cannot exclude them. To implement governance decisions as part of a democratic nation state or transnational civil society. Multilateral interaction should be broadened and deepened to include the voices of all citizens in decision making, irrespective of where they are or where they dwell. A call for integration and synergy of democratic governance, where knowledge from all cultures is recognized as equally important for progress in Africa. And then Kofi Annan said, we may have different religions, different languages, different colors of skin, but we all belong to one human race. We all share the same basic values. I'm ready for questions. And if you feel like contacting me, there is my email address. You're welcome to distribute it as widely as possible. And if you want to see more about my academic work, I'm leaving this link to you on the slide. Thank you very much for the opportunity. Over to our facilitator.
Thank you very much, Dr. Dries. Erika, Scream, it's all yours to make some questions, to share something about Brazil, your point of view.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Actually, I have a couple of questions for Professor Valthuysen. One of them is that I have taking the opportunity to read your dissertation on African Renaissance, and it was just incredible. So just in case you have a research team and you are willing on welcoming foreign students, foreign fellow researchers, I'm all available.
Oh, no, it was a work of youth, but I'm happy you enjoyed it.
Yeah, it's amazing. It's amazing. But I think it was really enriching for all of us to have the chance to hear you, to listen to your presentation on such important topics. And on what concerns, I mean, we're here among three members of countries that have all been colonized at some point. So you've mentioned the problem of colonialism, right? In the beginning of your presentation. So the whole system of the United Nations was abundant in actions to end the colonial relations, but not so much as to end the advantages of centuries that these colonial powers held over us. Here we have Angola, Brazil, South Africa. And this obviously reflects in our power relations, the way we pose ourselves internationally. Brazil and South Africa are part of the BRICS, an initiative meant to at least address the economic part of such disadvantages and propel us towards cooperation and development. I've been to some BRICS events in the past years. I've had the chance to meet Dr. Naledi Pandor, the Ministry of Foreign Relations of South Africa. And as you mentioned, climate migration, which is a serious issue for most of us coastal countries. And as this is a topic dear to my research as well, there is a recognizable relation between droughts, climate change, famine, poverty, and conflict. So inasmuch as this is a climate situation as well, it is also a matter of inequality, of disadvantage of centuries as well. So how do you see the advance of such conflicts over climate change for us developing countries in the next coming decades? Because this is not just a matter of climate, but also of land distribution, inequality, and some of the colonizing structures that still influence the way we deal with our problems. So how do you see it?
I think if you link the variables of colonialism, climate change, and poverty, you might come to very interesting conclusions. On the one hand, colonialism was definitely experienced in different places. But I would like to use the example of the way some peoples in Africa were driven away from their lands into the deserts and forests by colonial powers. Well, it also happened before colonialism, but during colonialism, those who didn't survive under the colonialist regimes had to find refugees somewhere, and they ended up in deserts and in forests. Now, that pattern continued after the so-called abolishment of colonialism, where there became a very distinct difference between those living in the cities with the so-called modern structures, modern post-colonial structures that were actually colonial, and then those living in the rural areas. In the rural areas, the pre-colonial structures were in most cases totally destroyed. So there was nothing to replace any way of participating in the rule by the center in the cities. And then because of that, violent conflict started. People were starting contesting each other for resources, scarce resources like land and food, etc. When climate change came in, that became more intense. So that served as an escalator for migration. There became a new wave of migration of people looking for greener grass, or believing that there are greener grass on the other side. So, and with that migration became many other relationship problems. They call it relationship problems between people meeting each other and we're not willing to look after migrants in the traditional way. You know, Tanzania, for instance, is such a beautiful land. Everybody come there are welcomed and looked after and say, okay, thank you, my brother, be on your way. But arriving in South Africa, they're simply not welcome. You know, there's not enough for everybody. You know, so it differs from country to country. And unfortunately, South Africa is still one of the flesh pots of Africa. So people like to come here. But that triangle between what were the history of colonialism, climate change and conflict, it will always be there, and then you can draw the arrow towards poverty.
Thank you so much, Professor. It was amazing to hear from you, definitely.
That was a long answer.
But that was great. I think we could, both of us, but me and Giselle, we could stay here listening to you all the whole day. So,
okay. Professor. Professor Dry, thank you very much again for your presentation. I think our academic community, all academic, will benefit of this presentation, Professor. Thank you very much, and see you soon.
Até outra vez. Muito obrigado.
Okay.
Outra vez, Professor.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you so much.